results of our Listening to Mothers in California survey. My name is Katie Martin. I'm the Vice President for Health Policy and Programs at the National Partnership for Women and Families. Before diving in, we want to gratefully acknowledge the California Healthcare Foundation and Yellow Chair Foundation for their generous support of this work. We also want to extend our sincere appreciation to Congresswoman Lee and her staff for hosting us today and for her leadership in this area. The National Partnership for Women and Families works towards equity and economic security for women and their families, and maternal and child health is central to that work. Listening to Mothers is based on the belief that women know best what they need and want and expect from the healthcare system, and today our findings are going to show that we are not meeting their expectations. We're falling short, particularly for women of color. The maternal mortality crisis illustrates the toll that structural racism is taking on Black women and their bodies, and brings into sharp relief the need to listen to mothers about what they want, what they need, and what they expect from the healthcare system. We will do that today. We will listen to mothers in two different sessions. First, we're going to focus on bias and discrimination in healthcare and disparities faced by women of color. And then at 10, we will dive more deeply into the survey results across the board. We are pleased to be joined by Dr. Carol Sakala, who will provide a brief overview of Listening to Mothers. Dr. Sakala is the Director of Childbirth Connection Programs at the National Partnership and is a passionate advocate for creating system changes that meet the needs and interests of childbearing women and their families. And she is the lead author of the Listening to Mothers survey. We will also hear from Dr. John Godbolt to present an analysis of the Listening to Mothers data about the experiences of women of color. Dr. Godbolt is a program associate at the National Partnership, focusing on health equity and maternal health. We also will be joined shortly by Dr. Joya Prior-Perry, the founder and president of the National Birth Equity Collaborative. And as everyone in this room knows, I'm sure, she is the leading voice on health equity and maternal and child health. So with that, we will start with Carol to give a broad overview and background on the Listening to Mothers survey. Thank you all so much for being here.
Thank you, Katie. So above all, maternity policies, programs, care, and experiences matter to women themselves. And at this time, many women are struggling. We have egregious, persistent, pervasive disparities, and in the best case situation, where the best case lands, all too often, this is completely unacceptable, even for example, white, privately insured women. So it is absolutely important that we carefully consider the views and experiences of childbearing women in our deliberations and decisions about policy, practice, education, and research. In 2002, Maureen Corey, Jean DeClercq, and I launched our Listening to Mothers surveys at the national level to understand better many things that we did not understand at that time. As we suspected, new moms were all too happy to share their experiences. They were grateful for us to give voice to their concerns. And they were willing to complete a questionnaire that we had been warned was too long, even as they told us they were stressed and tired. We repeated that survey in 2006 and 2012, continuing many core items and switching in new items to address evolving issues in the field. And in the last two surveys, we were privileged to be able to add a follow-up survey directed to the same women. And these have yielded immensely rich data sets that we've made public. As a result, we have dozens of publications about the experiences of childbearing women and their families in this country. And these are available on our website if you want to see a bibliography of those. This month we released our Listening to Mothers in California survey, our newest survey and our first one at the state level. And in many respects, it's the best yet. We responded in Spanish or English, and they responded 2 to 11 months after giving birth. And we're very excited to share highlights of our findings with you today. And now I'd like to ask my colleague, Donna Godbolt, to share with you the work that she and Stephanie Glover contributed to this project. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol, for that wonderful introduction to Listening to Mothers in California. In your handout on top, there should be a PowerPoint slideshow that you can follow along with. So as Carol mentioned, I'm going to highlight a few of the data points from the three briefs that we wrote that were listening explicitly to women of color in California, listening to Black mothers, Latina mothers, and Asian Pacific Islander mothers. And I want to reiterate Carol's point that while some of the shortcomings in the healthcare system are worse for women of color, they're also pretty bad for white women. So across the board, there's room for improvement, but I'm just going to focus now on Black, Latina, and Asian Pacific Islander women. And also before I start, this should be your second slide, if you're following along. Okay, so we wrote the three briefs, Listening to Mothers. California has a very high percentage of women of color, so the implications are far broader than just for the state of California. Let's see, in California there are 1 million Black women, over 7 million Latinas, who account for half of all births in California, and over 3.5 million Asian and Pacific Islander women. Mothers of color are often subject to discrimination and unfair treatment in healthcare, and this can contribute to disparities in both maternal and infant healthcare outcomes. In our survey, mothers of color report discrimination from their maternity care providers more frequently than white women. More than 10% of Black mothers, 5% of Latinas, and 8% of API mothers reported that they were treated unfairly during their hospital stay because of their race or ethnicity. Only 1% of white mothers reported the same. This is what one Black mother shared. The doctors were not communicating well. One doctor decided to argue with me when I explained that my baby had already had blood taken twice. He then threatened to not allow me to take her home if I didn't consent to a third blood test. Then he commented on how Black babies are almost always formula fed, but since I was insisting on breastfeeding, she needed to be monitored carefully. Mothers also reported discrimination based on the language they spoke. 10% of women who spoke Spanish as a first language and 8% of women who spoke the API language reported unfair treatment. Since we don't speak English, they don't take good care of us, reported one of the mothers of color also reported that they were handled roughly or experienced rude and threatening language from their healthcare provider. On average, 10% of Black mothers, 7% of Latinas, and 10% of API mothers reported this. Many of the mothers gave us quotes about nurses and doctors pulling at them and inflicting physical pain without explanation or apology. Communication during the labor process was also a problem for many of our mothers of color. Many of the mothers reported that they frequently faced barriers to open and supportive communication with their maternity care providers, and that medical staff did not support them during their labor. Almost one-third of Black and Latina mothers and 20% of API mothers reported that they did not feel the delivery room staff encouraged them to make decisions about their birth progression. One Black mother recalled that the worst part of her labor experience was being pressured into decision-making. 17% of Black mothers reported that they felt pressured to induce, 15% said they felt pressured to use an epidural, and 18% reported being pressured to have a cesarean birth, a rate twice that of white mothers. One mother reported, "When I arrived, the first doctor on the scene kept pressuring that a C-section early for her to say that. If I didn't have one of the nurses to be my advocate, I'm pretty sure the doctor would have performed the surgery. And we know that unnecessary cesarean births are associated with greater risk and cost. So pressure on women to have cesarean sessions is very concerning. Likewise, 11% of Latina mothers reported pressure to induce, use an epidural, and to have a cesarean. And 13% of API women felt pressure to induce, 11% felt pressure to have an epidural, and 14% felt pressure to have a cesarean birth. So post having their child, postpartum support is critical to help women in the days after giving birth, to help navigate the time of physical, emotional, and social transition. But many mothers of color reported that they did not have anyone to turn to for practical support or emotional support during this period. Nearly 10% of Black women, 20% of Latinas, and 13% of API women said they never had anyone to turn to for someone to talk to in the period following the birth of their child. And nearly 6% of Black women, 20% of Latinas, and 15% of API women said they never had anyone to turn to for help with getting things done. This is just a snapshot of the results of listening to mothers in California. They demonstrate that the healthcare system needs improvement to better serve all women, and particularly women of color. I'm happy now to pass the mic to Dr. Joya Carey, who's going to speak about the current state of affairs in maternal health. And we'll give her a hand as she sells her health.
New joke is, where's Julia? It's like, where's Waldo? So I am here and good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Pull out
my little speech.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Y'all look so lovely. Emma is here. All right. So I am honored to be here, and thank you for inviting me. Thank you, Dolly, as usual. Thank you to the National Partnership. I had a lovely time at the annual gala. It was beautiful. We're all over there. Anybody get to go? Okay. So thank you to all of you who are working on behalf, and our amazing partners and friends in the room, who are working on behalf of mothers and valuing mothers and families. It is a critical time to uplift the importance of this moment in defense of reproductive health, rights, and justice, and any attempt to repeal the long-fought rights we have gained towards reproductive freedom from the Affordable Care Act and Roe v. Wade. This latest attempt that we are currently in right now cannot let today pass without honoring that and saying how important it is for us to be in this house on this day talking about this important issue. It's tied to all the other things that are happening around us, right? And this attempt to assault on the judicial branch, which is a direct assault on women, families, Black women, and all other marginalized peoples in our country. So we're here to fight. We're here to learn together. Like all the people now. All right, as you may be aware, the United States is the only developed country in the world where maternal mortality rates are on the rise. Further, Black women in the U.S. die at 3 to 4 times the rate of their white counterparts. Despite clear evidence of this inequity, policymakers, and as a consequence, government, had not until now recently addressed this urgent public health issue. Regardless of our income or educational status, Black women have higher rates of maternal mortality. The definition of a maternal death is, according to the CDC, anybody from CDC here? Mm-hmm. It's important that if I say it wrong, you're right. It's the death of a woman while pregnant or within 1 year of the end of pregnancy, regardless of the outcome, duration, or site of the pregnancy from any cause related to or aggravated by pregnancy or its management. Based on that definition, the CDC found in their surveillance 2,726 women died in the United States between 2011 and 2014. Of those women, 1,010 were Black. So we represent about 38% of the deaths, despite not representing less than 6% of the population. As a black woman from the deep south who is an obstetrician and a mother, my strong desire to end this inequity is amplified every time I look to the faces of my daughter and my patients. As I mentioned, I cannot, as a black woman, buy or educate my way out of dying at 3 to 4 times the rate of white women in the United States. This inequity persists regardless of income or education. A white woman who has less than a high school education has a better chance to live in childbirth than a black woman with a college degree. The legacy of a hierarchy of human value based upon the color of our skin continues to cause differences in health outcomes, including maternal mortality. Racism is a risk factor, not black skin. There is no black gene. Maternal mortality extends beyond the period of pregnancy or birth. 9 months of prenatal care, no matter how amazing your doctor is, cannot counter underlying social determinants of health inequities in housing, political participation, transportation, education, food, environmental conditions, and economic security, all of which have their roots causes in racism, classism, and gender oppression. We have data that show that black women who initiate prenatal care in the first trimester still have worse outcomes than white women with later no prenatal care. Good maternal health outcomes depend on implementation of all sexual and reproductive rights, from comprehensive sexual education to access to all forms of birth control. We know that Medicaid expansion is critical to ensuring that maternal mortality rates improve across our great nation. We have data that shows, again, that investments in states such as my own great state of Louisiana saves money and lives. Even if women are insured, though, coverage of sexual and reproductive health services is often not comprehensive. Receiving the full range of options ensures safe, healthy births for moms and babies. Reproductive life planning in schools, health facilities, community organizations, and homes reinforces the tools for our future generations need to make healthy choices about when, how, and if they want to have children, and to optimize their physical, emotional, and fiscal health in order to build a stronger, more secure nation. Closures of hospitals and maternity units create barriers to services and information. This lack of a safety net for poor and rural Americans produces gaps in access along the reproductive lifespan. I am the founder of the National Birth Equity Collaborative and on the advisory committee for the Black Mamas Matter Alliance. The National Birth Equity Collaborative envisions a world where every black baby lives to their first birthday with their family. The Black Mamas Matter Alliance, any Black Mamas Matter folks in here? It serves as a national voice and a coordinating entity for stakeholders advancing maternal health, rights, and justice, and intentionally centers black women's leadership. BMMA has a network of organizations with reach, relationships, and capacity to support an intergenerational movement. It organizes around 4 core strategies, which aim to advance policy, which is doing stuff like this, which is important, cultivate innovative research, having researchers. Enhance holistic, comprehensive approaches for care for black mamas, including midwives and doulas. And shift the culture of the narrative around black motherhood, that we're broken and we're sick and we're old and we don't participate. We have to change that idea, that narrative. And amplifying the voices we have over 30 collaborating organizations, including Center for American Progress, across the country. When we began our work with the National Birth Equity Collaborative through funding with the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, we interviewed black women from 7 sites across the United States who had experienced an infant death. We knew that the foundation of our work had to begin with listening to women and centering their voices in research and advocacy, just as the National Partnership for Women and Families, as well as the California Healthcare Foundation. We knew that the voices too long had been ignored. We, like our partners here, recognize that far too many of our strategies, policies, and programs have been built based upon assumptions and bias without authentically listening to the communities who historically and currently have been ignored and harmed. This legacy of a belief of a hierarchy of human value, where both women and people of color were not considered fully human, continues to cause division and fear in this country. But I'm an optimist. Everybody knows I'm an optimist. We are witnessing the last gasp of a worldview that utilizes this belief of differential value to divide, to conquer, and to generate wealth for themselves while shortening the lives of the rest of us. Black women have a redemptive narrative. Trust us. We will continue to fight for equality, freedom, and justice for all, and take the licks in stride while we're doing it, right? We're reclaiming our time, as we say. This work is essential to the reproductive choice movement, because when we get free, we all get free. I recently started yoga. My 25-year-old daughter is very excited about that. And when I think about the fifth chakra, which I'll probably mispronounce. Any yogis in the house? Yeah. Which is within an authentic expression. It reminds us that we must collectively have to do with this moment and aligning the vishuddha. We ask ourselves, is what I'm about to say true? Is what I'm about to say necessary? Is what I'm about to say kind? And lastly, we've added, am I the correct messenger? In the battle to get free and ensure a world where all of our children and grandchildren can thrive, the answer to all these questions for women is a resounding yes. So listen to us. So in closing, ultimately what women and especially black women in the U.S. need is accountability. We need to know that our lives are valued. The accountability may be complicated, but government still has an obligation to act. Racism, classism, and gender oppression are killing all of us, from rural to urban America. And this is not about intentions. The lack of action is unintentionally killing us. So it's a human rights imperative. We must ensure that prevention efforts and resources are being directed towards the areas of greatest need and be willing to name the problem. We must listen and trust women and what they tell us about their bodies and their experiences in the healthcare system. So let's get on.
Share the mic here. You know, I'll just start off by saying it's incredible. incredibly important. And I think when we think about, you know, where these women sit in terms of like those that are experiencing this, I think it's beyond just women who may have experienced some of these maternal health issues, but also our elected officials. You know, they need to reflect the women of color and people of color that are enduring these issues. Also the physicians, the nurses, the doulas, you know, they all need to reflect the folks that have been disproportionately impacted, because I think that is the only way that we can sort of get to the authenticity that is needed to really understand what women are going through on a day-to-day basis. I don't know if other folks want to chime in.
So speaking from the perspective of somebody who does work for Asian Americans, Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islanders, I think for us it's really critical, and it's actually a testament to the partnership that Asian and Pacific Islander women were even surveyed in this report. So when we look at these populations, historically we've been invisible. We haven't been included in federal, national, state, or local or privately run surveys. And so therefore the needs of AAPI women have largely been invisible. And so it's really critical that we do center them in these part of these conversations. We do lay the groundwork, much as the partnership is doing, by conducting these types of surveys and gathering some level of baseline data. Because I would remind folks that when we're talking about these communities, we're talking about really diverse populations that are 60% immigrants, largely limited English proficient, one third. So they obviously, you know, these are part of the social determinants of health that we all know too well, and they have profound impacts on preconception and postpartum feelings, as well as healthcare outcomes.
And I'm going to ditto both of my esteemed colleagues on this panel, but also add more to that. You know, before I came to the National Health Law Program, I worked at the National ET Institute for Reproductive Health, so the reproductive justice framework is always how I have viewed my work. And as, you know, disability activists have said, you can't do anything about us without us. So it's very critical that these communities are part of these conversations, but also leading these conversations. So I think that this is such a foundational piece as we continue this dialogue about how we improve the lives of these women. And also, as I was reading the report and also the issue briefs, I kept thinking about, we also just need more data and research efforts that involve these communities early on and, you know, have them as collaborative stakeholders, because there's so many other groups of women as well, women of color living with disabilities, you know, queer women, and how they experience pregnancy that are not usually part of these conversations.
And just one more thing to add to, just on the note about elected officials and policymakers that reflect communities of color. And I don't know if we're going to get into this in this session, but, you know, in terms of the legislation that has been introduced this session, particularly on these issues, you know, those pieces of legislation have been led by people of color. And so I just want to note that, particularly, you know, folks in the Congressional Black Caucus, the Congressional Hispanic Caucus. So just wanted to put that out there, that we need to see that same leadership continue to echo and even build up as we try to address this issue.
Thank you. Yeah, and actually, Jamila, that's a great segue into the next question I was gonna put your way, which is, what are some of the policy options that are available to improve the birth experiences and the birth outcomes for women and children of color?
Right, well, if you all have had a chance to read the issue briefs and report, you'll recognize that, you know, this issue is not going to be tackled by one solution. You know, it is so complex and multifaceted. But in terms of a few things, I do have some ideas. I think for one, you know, as Joya mentioned in her remarks, you know, which were so great at setting the tone for the conversation, particularly for Black women, this is an issue that we see across income and education levels. And I know a lot of the conversations that we've been having here in Washington are really focused on access to healthcare. You know, expanding Medicaid is a piece of that. I think another policy solution would be to extend the period of, you know, healthcare support for women on Medicaid beyond, you know, 60 days. So, I mean, our recommendation would even be up to a year postpartum. I think that's key. We also talked about the issue of implicit bias and how we address that. You know, I will say that I feel like implicit bias is the buzzword these days. when we talk about particularly issues around maternal health, but I'll just also note that we also need to address more overt forms of racism that we see in our health system and I think other places, particularly where women of color interact with support services, we need to address them there. But in terms of policy-wise, there is a bill that Senator Kamala Harris introduced not too long ago, the Maternal Care Act. And what that does is to help ensure, you know, culturally competent, you know, care for women, and it also helps to ensure addressing implicit bias. I think the solutions in that space need to go beyond physicians. I know that training is already happening to those in medical school, and physicians, but I really think that the training needs to happen, you know, with any person that's interacting with a woman in the healthcare system, and so that means nurses and you know, even down to the folks that are checking women in, working in triage. So I think that's an important piece as well, and this bill gives at some of that. And then I also know that there is a conversation around how we can sort of get at some of the non-medical supports that women need. And so I think in terms of the policy space, we're still trying to figure out how to do that, how to make sure that women are connected with, you know, the community supports, you know, also making sure that they're accessing SNAP and WIC programs like that if they need them, housing, transportation. And I know there are some state programs that have done a good job of helping women have access to transportation. I know that's something here in DC that some of the community-based programs are doing, like Mama Toto Village, you know, which is an amazing organization. If you know nothing about it, please look them up. It's led by Black women, founded by Black women. They're also helping to support women who are homeless and pregnant. And so those are just a few ideas, and to me, those are low-hanging fruit. You know, we also have good programs in this country that are already in place. They're just not being implemented properly, and they don't have enough funding.
Yes, of course.
One addition to the policy, because there are not enough policy options. but there's a bill, the Health Equity and Accountability Act, and it's introduced in each congressional session. So this session, and it rotates amongst the congressional tri-caucus. So in this session, Congressman Barbara Lee, as healthcare task force co-chair of the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus, introduced it in the House with about 60 incredible co-sponsors, as well as Senator Rono is looking to introduce in the Senate in the next few weeks. And it's a comprehensive health disparities bill, so it addresses kind of the full spectrum of issues that affect mothers before they become mother, preconception, postpartum, as well as the children's health, and really centers on the community health as well, addressing many of the intersecting barriers that people face. I think, like Candace mentioned, right, when we talk about a woman of color, she's not just a woman of color, she might have a disability, she might be an immigrant, she might be limited in English proficient. So addressing all of these factors is really important.
Great, thank you both. And as we're kind of calling out bills that are helpful, I thought I would also mention the Mama's Act and the Mommy's Act, which both get at some of the core issues that Jamila raised around enhancing our Medicaid program to better serve pregnant women and a number of other important issues related to maternal health. So I just want to acknowledge that those bills are out there as well and definitely worthy of support, and I think will continue to get attention as we continue to pay attention to this maternal health crisis that's not going anywhere at the moment. So, Candace, I did want to turn to you and hear a little bit about your thoughts on what are some of the other policy options or strategies for tackling some of the specific disparities and barriers that were highlighted in the issue briefs or the report.
Yeah, so I'll definitely speak to some of the work that we're doing in California. So as the report mentioned, that women both in Medi-Cal insurance as well as in private insurance express a strong interest in having access to doulas for future birth. I think that also really ties into a lot of the issue briefs and sort of the lack of emotional support that women of color experience as well, and going along the lines of what Jamila mentioned. labor delivery, but also in their postpartum care. And specifically in California, what we're trying to do is to see whether Medi-Cal can cover doula services. And I think there's been a lot of conversation about how doulas can, help cut the rate of cesarean births. But also, it's just so important to look again at, as Jamila was saying, about the innumerable, immeasurable objectives, right? Like, and getting to the the emotional, practical support that women of color need during this process. As we've highlighted before, right, women of color experience so many life stressors outside of the experience of pregnancy, and also they face everyday discrimination. So it just makes sense to provide them and give them another layer of support as they continue their pregnancies. And I think we also, if we think of providing dual services as a viable policy option, right, we also have to imagine too that there are other things that we might not be able to get to with just that one policy again, right? Because obstetricians need to be trained. And birthing in this country, like so much of reproductive health care, has been hyper-medicalized to the point where, women and other people who need reproductive health care feel like their stories, their needs aren't centered in these conversations. So again, this is just one piece of how we can tackle these disparities. And especially, in the Medi-Cal program too, as we're thinking this through, the question then becomes, on the insurance side, do doulas have to become licensed? What are the reimbursement rates that they would, that they would need? And also, making sure that doulas are trained and have the cultural competency trained specifically so that they can meet the needs of Medi-Cal beneficiaries. But I think this is one of the policy solutions that could tackle the disparities that we saw in the report.
Can I say something about doulas too?
Yeah.
Of course, everything, Candace said is right and on point there. I think also something to think about in terms of doulas and any sort of policy change, whether it's Medicaid reimbursement or what have you, is that we need to be supporting doulas of color in those efforts. I know me personally, I have traditionally seen doulas as largely, white women who are paid by women out of pocket a lot of money to help them through the birthing process. And since I have started to work on maternal health issues, largely through my experiences with Black Mamas Matter Alliance, I have learned about the amazing work of community-based doulas and what they're doing to literally save women's lives. And these are women in their own communities. And so I also think that, those of us that are in this position to try to change this policy, we also need to think about ensuring that doulas of color are supported in the pipeline to be employed in these positions and trained and paid as they should be paid in an equitable manner. So just wanted to highlight that too.
Great. Thank you both for raising the important issue of doula care. My colleague Carol has done a lot of work on it, and I think we'll talk a little bit more about sort of the findings around doula services in the larger report as well. So thanks for bringing it up. Amina, I want to turn to you. I know that your organization has been really a leader around a lot of the immigration policy that's happening right now. And how does immigration status impact health, and how does the current environment, which is quite challenging, impact a pregnant woman's ability to access care or just have a healthy pregnancy?
So, I think just as we can't divorce the attacks on reproductive health and civil rights right now, we cannot ignore the concept of immigration and the role it plays in social determinant of health. So for API 40, for example, I mentioned there's 60% foreign born. That determines everything from the type of coverage you have, whether or not you're able to see a doctor, and ultimately your birth outcome. Right now, it's no surprise that immigrants are under attack by the Trump administration. And so this past Saturday, for example, the Trump administration announced that it was issuing a revised public charge ruling. For those of us who probably come from the healthcare side, probably a year ago, we didn't know what public charge was. I definitely did not. I would probably rather not. But unfortunately, we've all had to become an expert on benefits law as well as immigration law. And so it's an incredibly complex rule. It's been around for 100 years, and it's always been very narrowly interpreted. And essentially said, if you use very strict programs, things like traditional welfare, like cash benefits, then the government or an immigration official will look at you and see whether or not you might become a public burden, subject to, again, a very narrowly construed test. In effect, very few people met the public charge test, therefore very few people were denied entry to the U.S. Now the Trump administration, because it cannot do what it wants to do, perhaps through congressional action, and to accomplish many of the desires to rid the country of immigrants, is attempting a backdoor policy. And so now, under their revised public charge test, if an immigrant uses Medicaid, which is a profoundly new addition, if they use Medicare Part D, if they use SNAP to feed their children, if they use housing assistance to put a roof over their head, they can be denied the ability to enter the country through a visa, or they could be denied the ability to get a green card. And so, in practicality, what this means is that if we're looking at, say, a pregnant woman who perhaps has a child already who's born in the U.S., she's working two jobs, she's relying on Medicaid to pay for her prenatal care, which we all know is in our entire nation's benefit for our public health, something we all will benefit from. She could be denied the ability to get a green card and stay here permanently with her U.S. citizen child just because she took a helping hand from a publicly paid program that she's legally eligible for. So this has profound implications, not just for the people who are in the programs, but also the chilling effect, which is much worse. So right now, we're already hearing heartbreaking stories, women who are withdrawing from, who have withdrawn from the WIC program because they thought that might be subject to it. The fact that the new regulation would essentially say, if you're young and under 18, if you don't have a high level of education, if you don't speak good English, if you're not super likely to be employed, then you know what, we don't want you in this country. That's essentially what the regulation says. So this has enormous consequences. It's something that we at the Health Forum have been working on with the Protecting Immigrant Families campaign and other national ANHPI partners. So if your bosses are not knowledgeable or you all are not working on public charge, definitely reach out to me and I'm happy to put you in touch with the campaign. There's enormous infrastructure that's working to respond to this regulation once it's posted.
Great, thank you for drawing those important connections between immigration status and health. I don't think that that's always at the forefront of the conversation, but it really should be. We only have a few minutes left before we turn to Q&A, but Jamil, I want to follow up on something you said earlier about implicit bias. So we know there's mechanisms in place to address training on implicit bias and cultural competence, but clearly those mechanisms are falling short. So can you help us understand why that is or what other mechanisms might be more effective?
Well, I think it's falling short because, you know, traditional mechanisms that have been used to train medical providers, largely physicians, are based on, you know, sort of checking a box, right? So once they go through the training and, you know, any sort of check-in or evaluation that's done, it's like, oh, I can check the box that I, you know, mentioned, or I asked a woman or about, you know, her, I made sure that I had someone in the room that could speak Spanish, you know, for example, if she was not English speaking. And I think we need to go beyond that, especially because, you know, we see what the numbers look like in terms of maternal mortality, and so I think we need a more substantive, quality assured way to train, again, not just physicians, but also nurses and others that interact with women in the healthcare system. I also think we need to talk about what compassionate care looks like and what, you know, women-centered care looks like. Because I don't hear that enough in the conversation. And, you know, one of, I mentioned Mama Toto Village earlier, and so our colleague, Azadeh Diri, who runs an organization, you know, she said, you know, you can't keep people from being racist, or you can't erase racist attitudes by training. And so for me, you know, your sort of role in being a healthcare provider is to sit with your patients and treat them with compassion and humanize them, which is something that, you know, Dr. Perry mentioned in her remarks. And so I think if we start there, we can have a better, more substantive, I think, conversation and training mechanisms when it comes to addressing bias. And again, you know, not only focusing on implicit bias and more covert sort of ways that we see racism pop up in these settings, but I think also more conversation is still so focused on medical settings. I also think that's a problem. I think we need to do more to also support women's birthing choices, and her choices may be to have her child outside of the hospital. And so I think we also need to be thinking more about what that looks like, making sure that insurance coverage is available if she wants to use a community-based birthing center or even have her child at home. So we'd love to continue to also think through that with those of us that are working in this space.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I'm sure we will continue a lot of that conversation, so I appreciate that. I do want to open it up to the audience to see if anybody has questions for the panelists, but also John and I are happy to speak more to the and for Joya. Yeah. Good. So any questions?
And Stephanie, can I ask both also add another piece to the immigration picture?
Go on for it, yes, please.
So also outside of just the fear of immigration enforcement in this country, immigrants have been barred from a lot of insurance programs as well. So under Medicaid, legal permanent residents cannot apply to a Medicaid program until they've had 5 years of status. And so there's actually a bill that we, Mom and I, worked on for several, how many years now? it's a champion by Representative Michelle Lujan Grisham. It's called the Heal for Immigrant Women and Families Act. And it would remove the 5 year bar on Medicaid, as well as open up options on the marketplaces as well. So I think, you know, immigrants already lack access to health insurance coverage, which that means that they lack access to care. And then they have to really rely on the safety net in this country, and the safety net is being chipped away, as we've seen under this administration, particularly with the Title X proposed rule. So that's just one more piece of the conversation on immigration, and hopefully look into the Heal for Immigrant Women and Families Act if you haven't seen it before.
Great, thank you. Yeah.
I just wanted to say, I don't know if anyone was going to ask any questions about this, but I didn't see any hands pop up quickly. But we did talk about mental health, and I did want to draw out one of the findings from listening to Mother's Project was the fact that, you know, 30% for Black women, 30% of them talked about issues with anxiety. While being pregnant or right after they had their child, and then 20% talked about depression, experiencing those things. And I think that this is also something else that we need to bring more into the conversation about addressing maternal health issues and even mortality for women of color. Speaking from an experience as a Black woman, access to mental health care is still an issue for us. We also have to deal with stigma around mental health issues, and so I think there's also something we can be doing more to lift up, access to mental health care and ensuring that it's also either integrated or connected with, the postpartum care that women receive.
Thank you, and I think your team put out like an issue briefer report on exactly that topic, right? So that's a great resource.
The Tri Conference bill, I was excited you brought it up, because even when Britt was here with Congresswoman Christensen, I remember fighting this Tri Conference. And thinking about this opportunity that we have in this room to have essentially a Tri Conference moment, and what does it look like for this conversation for maternal health and coming together across our different ethnicities and races, and what can we do together? Because I do a lot of Black woman stuff, and I do, but it's hard to find spaces where we can come together and do things.
It's a good question. I think for us, we've been also trying to be very intentional with cross-racial work into our funded medical law foundation to do similar things. I think in that sense, the health equity bill is actually far more than just a legislative vehicle. Been actually an avenue to create collaboration amongst partners, and partners being folks like us, Hill staff, advocates, providers, researchers, who otherwise wouldn't talk to each other, right? So for those of us who are doing NHPI help, we're now, you know, forced in a great way to work with our African American colleagues, and vice versa, to include the disability community, to include the queer community. So in that sense, I would encourage folks that if you're not part of the Health Equity Community Working Group, to let me know. It's a listserv of over 3,000 advocates nationwide. So you don't have to be part of an organization to join. You can join your own capacity as well. And it really tries to benefit and try to create a vehicle towards collaboration, understanding that we all work with different silos.
I also would say, but just that we could also look at taking a subset of that group or offering to that coalition a focus on maternity and sort of really use that great infrastructure that you all have to convene around a specific issue.
A statement and a question. The statement is the National Medical Association is part of the National Physician Alliance that includes the National Medical Association, the Alaska Native and Pacific Islanders, and Native Americans. When we look at all issues across the board in terms of providing care, and certainly we've been focusing on tribal resources, and so that's one that. My question is, we're sitting here in the nation's capital, Washington, D.C., and our maternal mortality rate is obviously a pandemic of 3,400. So I applaud your report from California and the survey that's done. I certainly hope that you address this issue in Washington, D.C. Our medical facilities for maternal health has closed. We have people that have been told at 7.5 months when they're trying to get an appointment, they can get an appointment 3 months from now. Absolutely. And so again, information that you have to spread the word and request more hearings, because it is absolutely unconscionable that in this country that we are allowing families and infants to die from disease. And provide a certain need to be trained. We're doing a lot in the area of cultural competency, inclusion, diversity, etc. And that's certainly it's getting into the schools as well. So thank you.
Thank you for that statement. And I'll just say too, I mean, as you mentioned, Washington, D.C., there is, you know, a state of emergency right here in our backyard. Particularly, you know, you mentioned, you know, maternity wards being closed, particularly in
GW is supposed to be opening up a hospital, so the question becomes, who's gonna service the women, who's gonna be working there, are they gonna be connected to community organizations that are already over there, how long is that gonna take, like, all the things to hold them accountable. This whole time, all of it, like, all of it, right? So.
And I have to say too, even with GW, you know, and again, you know, this comes from the community-based organizations like Mama Toto who have stepped in to support these women, that, you know, some of the women that they work with have not had positive experiences there. And so that's a problem too, you know, particularly when you are, and that's where the compassion thing comes in, right? You know, particularly if you're working with vulnerable communities, you know, how you create a person, you know, even have the voice on the phone that they hear. I mean, a woman having a bad experience, let's say it's her first time going into a hospital or a healthcare provider, you know, that would be enough to keep her from going back. And so we really need to hone in on the compassion piece.
Great. Well, I think we'll end it there.
Hi everyone, my name is Beth Karbowski. I'm the Director of Midwifery Practice Education and Global Outreach at the American College of Nurse Midwives. And I wanted to say thank you for mentioning midwives as part of this solution. For those of you who might not be familiar with nurse midwives and certified midwives in the US, there are about 12,000 of us, and we deliver about 8.4% of all of the children born in the US for that's final data for 2016. And central to our philosophy and our care is actually listening to women and providing women-centered care. And when you take a look at other countries that are doing a better job than we are with maternal morbidity and mortality, one of the key things that they have in their healthcare systems are more midwives. And so there's going to be ongoing discussions to come, but I just wanted to say thank you for mentioning midwives and doulas as a significant potential solution to what we're facing here. And to say if you aren't familiar with nurse midwives and certified midwives, to visit www.midwife.org. We do some pretty amazing work.
Yes, you do. Thank you so much. So I am